Hi, I'm Mac Thornberry from Texas, Chairman of the Armed Services Committee. When we talk about defense, we usually talk about billions of dollars and programs and whatnot. But the consequence of the vote we're about to take is about real life, flesh and blood. Earlier this week, a grandmother called one of my district offices. I'd appointed her or nominated her grandson to one of the academies. He's a pilot in the military. And her message to me was, please ground all the planes until you know for certain that they're safe for my grandson to fly in. Understandable, given the terrible accidents as recently as last week. Well, the bill we're about to vote on turns the corner in fixing our planes and ships and readiness, and it also sends a very strong message to allies and adversaries alike that the United States is going to stand up and defend ourselves. And that's more important because it's something we're doing than just things that we're saying. And I want to specifically thank the Speaker for his dedication and his commitment to rebuilding the military. You know, if everything's important, then nothing's important. And throughout this process, fixing our military has been the most important thing, the most important priority that the Speaker has worked toward. I think it's the most important thing in this bill. I think defending the country is the most important thing that the federal government does. And there's at least one grandmother in Texas who is very grateful for what we're about to do for her grandson and for his colleagues. Mr. Speaker.
Thank you, ma'am. Well, I want to start by thanking you, Mac, Chairman Thornberry, for joining me today, but also for your leadership on this issue. No one knows the issues surrounding our military and the needs better than Mac Thornberry. He knows what's at stake in this funding bill. As Secretary Mattis has discussed it, he's come here so many times with various hearings and testimony. The fundamental question that comes down in this bill is whether we're going to preserve the primacy of the American military in the 21st century. That's really what's going on right here. We have the greatest fighting force in the world, but we have asked them to do so much more with so much less for so long. Under the last administration, keeping a modern military force was simply not a priority, and the result has been a staggering readiness crisis that has cost us American lives. Today, we begin to reverse that damage. Yes, this bill is critical for many, many other reasons. This bill starts construction on the wall. It turns the gateway decision over to the Trump administration. It funds our war on opioids. It invests in infrastructure. It funds school safety and mental health. But what this bill is ultimately about, what we fought for so long, is finally giving our military the tools and the resources it needs to do the job. Just last week, I mean, your networks covered this. Your networks covered this. Sorry, Scotty, you always get me there. Just last week, but we lost two naval aviators, F-18 pilots, off of Key West because of a training accident. We lost 7 service members in a helicopter crash in Western Iraq. 9 people last week alone because of equipment. We continue to lose more American personnel to accidents and training incidents than we do to enemy fire. That is just unacceptable. It comes back to resources and training. That's why this bill is so important. We provide the biggest increase in military funding in 15 years. We provide the biggest pay raise for our troops in 8 years. I've got buddies who have done 6, 7, 8 tours in combat, who leave their families home every time. One of my buddies from Janesville is over in Afghanistan right now. And, you know, I think these guys deserve, these men and women in harm's way deserve our support. They deserve the best equipment. They deserve the best training, the best resources, and they deserve a pay raise. And that's what we're getting them. We're boosting resources for training, for equipment, for maintenance, for base operations. This means new naval ships, new fighters, new Apache and Black Hawk helicopters. It means a stronger missile defense system. What all this adds up to is that we are rebuilding the American military and creating a 21st century fighting force. The threat of American military decline is now coming to an end. That is a promise that we made along with this president to the American people, and it is a promise that we are keeping today, and we're pleased to do so. Questions? Anna. We will take anything we can get with our partners in government. We're going to work on all fronts. Number one, we regret the fact that the House passed a repeal and replace bill, a massive, the biggest entitlement reform bill ever considered in a Congress. Unfortunately, the Senate did not pass that. So we're going to keep going at that issue. I also think when it comes to the Farm Bill and other welfare programs on our workforce development program, we can get some good welfare reforms there as well. Christina. Well, the challenge is, first of all, did the process take longer than we had hoped this week? Yes, but it was a process where you had negotiations between Republicans and Democrats, House and the Senate. But we have a hard deadline we're going up against, and you know the deadline. But I would say that what's important is that this bill has been worked on for months. We passed these bills in the House last September. The Appropriations Committee, through their committee-led bottom-up process, has been working on this bill, drafting this bill, negotiating this bill for days, weeks, and even months. So it's not as if these are big surprises. So these things have been long works in progress. The finishing touches came out this week, and we have a hard deadline we're working up against. Let me just go over here, then I'll come back over there. Casey.
Mr. Speaker, the president's lawyer, John Dowd, has just resigned. Does that concern you?
Didn't know anything about it. I have no thought on it. Manu. Yeah, look, you know my thoughts about Vladimir Putin and Russia. They're a menace. Vladimir Putin does not respect democracy. He's trying to do everything he can to undermine democracies, not just ours, but all of our allies. I would not have kind words to say if I were speaking to him. I think what you're seeing here in Congress with our sanctions and the rest is we're calling Russia to the carpet. I don't know the content of that conversation, but my thoughts about Putin and Russia are pretty darn clear. Rachel. That didn't get included in here for various reasons. Chief among them was that they wouldn't agree to hide protections. So if we didn't have the support for putting it in here now, I have a hard time seeing how we would have support for putting it in again. Hide protections are something we cannot, that are non-negotiable for us. I'm sure the Democrats will want to work with us on this. No, we think there's more we can do. And so this is not just a technical correction discussion, which we have to have that. The way we look at tax reform, first of all, we had the co-op fix in here, which we think is very important. But what I've learned from studying tax reform systems for a long time is that when you convert your international system from worldwide to territorial, like the Brits did, like the Japanese did, there are going to be details that you miss. There are going to be lessons that you learn. We're going to take some more time to get those lessons, and I believe by the end of the year we'll have some lessons learned, meaning some technical fixes that will have to happen. And if we're going to go back and do that, we might as well try and make the tax code even better, and that's something that I think we want to look at doing. Yeah.
This bill only provides for about 30 miles of actual new fence along the border. What do you say to Republican voters, to the president's supporters who are still looking for that big, beautiful
this bill has funding that lasts for 6 months. And we're putting the administration's full request for the border and for border security and the wall in here for the next 6 months. A 1 year's worth of requests in 6 months. This actually has more wall funding and more wall allotment than the administration's request had. So we even do more in this bill than what the president's budget asked us to do. So we're going to be getting a down payment and starting on the border security. And by the way, border security means a lot of things. It means a wall. It means a levee. It means see-through. It means resources. it's a very diverse border. What we do is we listen to the Border Patrol. What do you need? Where do you need it? And we listen to them who tell us, based on the conditions on the ground, these are the physical barrier structures that are necessary. That's what we're funding here. And we're getting a good head start on it. Yeah. Yeah, well, I think obviously, by and large, we've done a phenomenal job of that. I think what happens is when you run against these tough deadlines, as you know, the House passed all of its appropriation bills well ahead of schedule. As you also know, the Appropriations Committee has been having hearings and markups all along. So this isn't as if it was a one-week process. This has been a months-long process. And the negotiations took longer. Why? Because we had to negotiate with Democrats and with the Senate. So those took a little longer than we had anticipated, but we have a deadline we have to move up against, and we don't want to see a shutdown in the meantime. So, because we have a deadline, we want to get up. We want to get, and our members also have a deadline. But also, we have a member who passed away, whose funeral is tomorrow, and we want to be sensitive to that as well. I'm invited to the White House all the time. Yeah. Yes. Oh, yeah. Yeah, yeah. The president supports this bill. There's no two ways about it. When we do big legislation, it's very common for me to go brief the president on the contents of big legislation. We do that all the time. In a bill like this, where you have lots of misinformation or confusion surrounding a bill like this, it's important. Take Gateway, for example. The House passed bill had very specific language in Gateway that basically steered the money to one predictable project. We stripped that language from this bill so that there's more discretion for the administration, and other cities like Chicago or Philadelphia could get those transportation dollars. So it was important for me to explain these things, and on big bills, that's typically what I do with the president, to walk him through, you know, the contours and the complexities of the legislation we pass. And yes, he supports the bill. No two ways about it. Last question.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Juliana Goldman with CBS.
Okay.
To follow up on Manu and Mary's question, when you met with the president yesterday, did you address the call with Vladimir Putin?
We just talked about appropriations legislation.
And then how did you respond to the
I think he liked it. I think he liked it because the administration asked us for $1.6 billion for the border, for the wall, and we got it. So he was happy with that. Thank you.